Hello and welcome everyone to our live stream mini conference during this mass quarantine entitled China Theory, Practice, Embodiment, and Extension. Before we get started, I would like to quickly say that I apologize for the lack of subtitles for the live stream of this conference. However, this conference will be posted to YouTube with subtitles later. I would also like to take a moment to thank Jessica Vavra Kesslering and our professor, Andrew Culp, as well as our two guest speakers, Stephen Shen and Max Rippon. Originally, we had hoped to be speaking in person with you at the public school in Chinatown, but here we are, and I'm grateful that we are all doing well, and we also hope that you, our viewers, are also taking precautions to stay safe, happy, and be thriving. Our conference today is a project in conjunction with the WAP lecture series normally held at the West Hollywood Library and with our course Critical Discourse in the Arts at CalArts. Our semester's theme was an exploration in Chinese contemporary thought, and that is exactly what you'll be hearing from all of our speakers today, an exploration in thought. We hope to open up conversations surrounding China and have a vulnerable moment of learning. I will start the conference, and then Jessica will speak, followed by Stephen, and finally a talk from Max Rippon of the Quarantine Gallery. After that, we will have a Q&A session and take questions you wish to ask through the ongoing chat. So if you have a question, please go ahead and put it down before you forget. Also, please be kind to yourself and others when placing comments. We are here to learn, make mistakes, rethink, and grow. Thank you again for joining us, and we hope that you enjoy. My name is Elizabeth Jafari, and I am a second year MA student in the Aesthetics and Politics program at CalArts. I defend on Tuesday, and my current research mostly deals with globalization and American and Japanese popular culture. Today, however, I'll be working through a theory of hybridization in conjunction with the aesthetic of basketball in China. So I am going to see if is there a way for me to show the slideshow? If not, I'll just go ahead and get to the paper.
Is it not allowing you to share screen?
It's not allowing me to share screen.
Oh, there we go. We can see
okay,
it.
Okay, you can see it now?
Mm-hmm. Cool. Yes.
But let's see. I'm so sorry to take up your time.
Yeah, you should be able to select present in the upper right-hand corner.
Present in the upper right-hand corner?
There's a button, present.
Oh, yeah, I know, yeah. But it's like the... Oh. Okay, we're good. We're
fine. Good, yay. Okay, cool.
thank you, Jessica. And I apologize for my incompetence. All right. All right. Well, hello. My title is Slam Dunk Sneakers in China. So even before the COVID-19 global pandemic, China has been a hot topic in global financial and political news. Whether it is the cherished theme of the China threat in America media and in Congress discussions, or the news of civil unrest between Chinese students and the government, China holds a space as an up-and-coming dominant global actor and experimentation ground for redefining not only its culture, but how the global culture is imagined. In the smallest of capacities and what my discussion will cover, basketball as a national pastime in China, the popularity of the Japanese anime and manga series Slam Dunk amongst Chinese youth, and the emergence of sneaker culture from American brands in China demonstrates a reconfiguration of the here, there, and east-west binary distinction in cultural exchange. Basketball as a sport and aesthetic in the United States, Japan, and China participates in a triad flow of cultural export and exchange, as seen in my Sharpie drawings here. Though animosities and past atrocities done to each country and by each country are not forgotten nor nullified by this exchange of basketball, this shared culture and shared aesthetic of basketball can provide a moment of connection that transcends unrest and provide insight into a potential future. What had spurred my thought process for thinking of the triad flow was a small comment made in Andrew Morse's essay, I Believe You Can Fly, Basketball Culture in Post-Socialist China, where he stated that today's Chinese basketball reflects a language of globalization. This is a statement that I both agree and contest. Most of Morris's essay does provide an essentialized here-there distinction by discussing basketball culture and market in such a way that it seems as though basketball has and always is originating from America. Possibly it is a matter of semantics, but I believe that today's Chinese basketball reflects a language of hybridization through a decentered flow as represented in the triad pictured. And the triad represents the interlinked economies and cultural influences between three entities. Previous distinctions of colonized, east-west in imperialism and post-colonial studies, or even the term globalization, are completely valid and historically necessary to create this triad. But a recognition that lines between these categories and the reductionist answer of globalization does not reflect how history and cultural identities have evolved. Hybridization begins to describe the phenomena that we are currently experiencing. As Professor of Mass Media and Communication Studies, Dr. Fabian Darling Wolf writes, quote, recognizing, however, that the hybrid product of global interconnectedness are inescapable and that the imagination they foster is a key component of our contemporary order is merely a necessary first step in understanding our historical moment, end quote. The cultural interconnectedness of all three of these countries through the shared aesthetic of basketball culture decenters the east-west binary distinction and creates a hybridity in which no particular region holds direct ownership of the aesthetic of basketball culture. For example, the CBA, Chinese Basketball Association, JBL, Japanese Basketball League, and the NBA, National Basketball Association, are currently hybrid communities that share basketball culture and are in constant conversation with one another, not only through traded players, but through commodities that reflect the aesthetic of basketball, like an athletic sneaker from a transnational company in global markets. Basketball culture is an example of an aesthetic that continually informs and transforms each country involved with the exchange of the aesthetic. So to begin, I will give a brief historical exchange of the history of basketball in China. Pictures. Basketball was introduced in China during the late 1800s and popularized by the 1920s. According to Morris, instructors from the YMCA, Young Man's Christian Association, introduced the sport in the 1890s. And in the 1920s, basketball became popular in urban centers and as part of physical education in schools, resulting in 1935 when basketball was voted to be a national pastime. For the sake of time, this history is similar to how basketball came about in Japan as well, but there are different circumstances surrounding this, and Japan does not consider basketball to be a national pastime. Moving on, the simplified version of the introduction of basketball in this particular instance shows a binary beginning from a micro result of Western imperialism in China. From this initial introduction, basketball became localized and popularized amongst the youth over time through films, magazines, and even a Chinese basketball Olympic team in 1936. basketball became a source of national pride and identity that survived even through its communist regime. Morris discusses the unwavering popularity of basketball with, quote, "If basketball was a national pastime of old China introduced by the hated and hegemonic American imperialists, this did not damage the game's utility in the new PRC, People's Republic of China. Until the soccer boom of 1990s, basketball was clearly the most popular sport at elite and popular levels in China. Even in the face of economic and political reform, the love for the sport did not fade. Even with anti-American sentiments, basketball did not disappear from being a part of Chinese culture. Instead, it continuously evolves and is as much a part of youth culture in China today as it was when it was first introduced. For example, a current popular player, CBA player Ding Yangyuan, and previous popular player Yao Ming, which both have played for the CBA and NBA, are figures that draw attention to the CBA and seek to challenge the concept of ownership of the sport as something not solely American, but part of a global culture of basketball as part of an identity for China. Beyond notable players, basketball is an aesthetic for youth identity in China that creates a space for shared experience within the triad through other media, such as the Japanese anime and manga series Slam Dunk. The Japanese anime and manga series Slam Dunk creates a shared experience between American, Japanese, and Chinese basketball. Slam Dunk's story is a comedy revolving around the broken-hearted delinquent and leader of a gang, Sakuragi Hanamichi, and his journey to joining his high school basketball team to impress the girl that he likes. It's your typical cheesy 90s anime filled with heartfelt moments and team building and friendships forming over the course of 101 episodes and 31 volumes of manga. Japanese and American cartoons were allowed to be viewed in China under an open door policy in the 1980s, and the influence of Japanese popular culture began to mirror Japanese popular culture success in America from the 90s, when we seemed to really, really, really buy into it as well. Nakano Yoshiko's essay, Shared Memories, Japanese Popular Culture in China, she reported, quote, "In 1998, Slam Dunk, an anime about a high school basketball team, was the rage in high schools and universities in Chinese cities. In Nanjing, male students hung posters in their dorms of Sakuragi Hanamichi, a good player with bad grades and a wild hairdo, and rented 31 volumes of its manga imported from Taiwan at manga rental shops on campus, devouring them one after another." Yoshiko also interviewed a male student in Nanjing at the time and recorded the student stating, quote, "I don't think about the massacre of Nanjing when I read Slam Dunk," end quote. The massacre of Nanjing was a horrific chapter in the Second Sino-Japanese War, in which Imperial Japanese soldiers killed more than 300,000 Chinese civilians. However, in this small moment of the student reading Slam Dunk, he is not engaged in what had happened in Nanjing, does not choose to have an awareness of Slam Dunk's origin, but rather is engaging in something that represents his identity of being a student and playing basketball. I am not trying to say that cultural objects such as Slam Dunk erase or lessen the atrocities that occurred, as there is still anti-American and anti-Japanese sentiments in China. But there is a separation between history and identification with the aesthetic of basketball, as the students of the basketball team are enjoying a story about a basketball team that happens to be coming from a Japanese import. The triad mobilizes here the aesthetic of basketball, resonating with creators of Slam Dunk, to these students in Nanjing becoming fans of the series, and to the concept of the achievement of a slam dunk that was popularized by Michael A. Jordan, all working together in creating a global hybrid culture of basketball. The expansion of sneaker culture in America, China, and Japan is another way that the triad of hybrid identities in basketball culture continues to cycle and interlink economies. Each country in the triad has seen recent spikes in desires to have designer and brand name sneakers like Nike, or Japanese brands like ASICS, Chinese brands like Li Ning, as well as the Beijing-based company Hanson Footwear, as mentioned by Morris. Seeking to compete and create their own identities in highly competitive global markets of athletic shoes, and thus creating a hybridized shoe culture through the process of globalization. For example, in an attempt to outdo the Nike Air Jordans, Hanson Footwear tweaked R. Kelly's song, I Believe I Can Fly, which was the main theme for the 1997 Space Jam film featuring Michael A. Jordan, whose name does belong to the Nike Air Jordan sneaker, to Do You Dream of Slam Dunking? Maybe You Could. I Believe You Can Fly, for their marketing campaign and slogan. Though I have had a hard time finding an example of the shoe from Hanson, and these are some examples of one, the Air Jordans, and a Nike line that was supposed to represent the Chinese New Year. The idea behind reappropriating the song that references Jordan reveals a process of globalization of Michael A. Jordan's image and the slam dunk. This global imagination of the ideal achievement for basketball culture is then put into the consciousness of participants in Chinese basketball culture through Hanson's shoe advertisement. As Robinson Tye Frazier states in his essay, Sneakers as Subculture, Emerging from Underground to Upper Ground, sneakers have a traditional function and an aesthetic function. In this instant, Hanson's marketing explores the ways in which hybridized aesthetics target young Chinese basketball players for not only profit and utility, but to create a continuation of basketball culture in China. There is a triad of exchange, creation, and sharing of hybrid cultures that has been occurring through this small example of basketball. The move of the slam dunk, for instance, creates yet another moment of cultural sharing. Whether it is the anime slam dunk, the promise of Chinese shoe manufacturers like Hanson of making the slam dunk with their shoe, or an image of Michael Jordan completing a slam dunk, there is a shared desire in basketball culture to achieve this feat of the slam dunk. As Haruko Akagi, the female love interest in slam dunk, states, a dunk is the best part of basketball. Haruko reinforces this ideal move, by calling our attention to the fact that the dunk is what players strive to achieve both physically and aesthetically. Though I do know that racism, scandals, and inequalities run rampant within the sport, and though I do know that the scars of imperialism and war may never heal for these countries, the interlinked economies and hybridization of things like basketball culture is a product of our evolution in history and reshaping our cultural identities. Though maybe it's a naive statement to make, perhaps in these small moments of cultural interconnectedness, middle grounds can be found and peaceful competitions can occur. So thank you very much for listening. And now I will be passing the torch on to Jessica with her talk, Micromodes, Resistance of / Through the Everyday. Thank you again.
Okay, thank you. Can you hear me? Okay, great. Thank you so much, Liz. For some reason, my computer wasn't working there for a second. So I'm just going to share my screen. Okay, can you see that, the full screen? Okay, thank you. So, hi everyone, I'm Jessica Vavra Kesselring, and I thank you so much for being here today. I'd like to thank the other speakers, Stephen Chen, our guest artist, who I believe plans to speak on abjection and the politics of virality in the corona scene. He may have changed a few things, but the world changes day to day, so I'm very excited to hear what he has to say. Thank you to Max from Quarantine Gallery for being here today as well. Also, thank you, Liz, for being here and co-hosting this event. And a heartfelt thank you to our advisor, Andrew Culp, Dr. Andrew Culp, who encouraged us to proceed amidst this chaos, sadness, worry, and trauma of this COVID-19 pandemic. Our conference really would not exist without you. And thanks to everyone in YouTube land for tuning in to our live stream today. I'd like to think of what I'm presenting to you today as a sort of full circle exploration event for me personally. Much of my research interests include my days in undergrad, including my days in undergrad at San Jose State, involve the politics of the everyday. So from a more feminist perspective, specifically feminist, we could look at the work by Emma Sokowitz. When Columbia University updated its class day and commencement guidelines in May 2015, prohibiting, quote, large objects which could interfere with the proceedings or create discomfort to others in close crowded spaces shared by thousands of people, end quote, many believe the change occurred as a direct response to Emma Sokowitz's senior art thesis titled Carry That Weight. The artist was raped in her dorm room while attending Columbia University. And due to inaction on the part of the college to ensure her safety, they did not suspend the rapist. Sokowitz created her senior art thesis, which is an endurance performance piece where she carries her dorm room mattress in public from morning to night. So the artist displayed rules of engagement on a large studio wall, which I'm not showing here, dictating that she could receive help carrying the mattress, but may never ask others to assist her. And she did not know how long the performance ultimately would last. Its conclusion was dependent upon the school suspending her attacker. One quote from the Columbia Daily Spectator mentions it could take, in an interview with her, says Sokowitz mentioned it could take a day or it could go on until I graduate. Sokowitz does end up graduating, mattress in tow, and suggesting that her attacker was never suspended. So the everyday as a means of political upheaval is also found in artist Kubra Kademi's work. In Armor 2015, it's also known as Armor Piece, a cell phone video captures the artist Kubra Kademi as she takes to the streets of Kabul, wearing custom-made armor that accentuates her breasts and buttocks. Iranian-born artist Kubra Kademi was exiled from Afghanistan after this 2015 performance of Armor. And many of Kademi's other pieces engage the everyday and gestural art of walking. In Armor, on the streets of Kabul, the artist remains covered from head to toe, and she is surrounded by swarms of men whooping and yelling. Some of the men attempt to grab the artist for their own amusement or perhaps to punish her. And because of the increasingly violent crowd situation, she ends up quickly climbing into her colleague's vehicle. And essayist and feminist June Jordan helps us to connect the experiences women face expressed through performance pieces. In particular, she argues that there is a, quote, universal experience for women, which is that physical mobility is circumscribed by our gender and by the enemies of our gender. This is one of the ways they seek to make us know their hatred and respect it. This holds throughout the world for women, and literally, we are not to move about in the world freely. If we do, then we have to understand that we may have to pay for it with our bodies. That is the threat. They don't ask you what you're doing in the street. They rape you and mutilate your body to let you remember your place. You have no rightful place in public. Cooper Kadamy's performance, walking fully clothed yet inciting chaos by way of accentuated female attributed biological features, demonstrates how frequently and openly sexual violence can occur despite a woman's everyday action of walking, and no matter her clothing. In 2016, Cooper Kadamy sits at a Parisian cafe and reflects upon her experience performing Armor, citing that the work explores a woman's everyday walk and draws attention to the sheltered existence of Afghan women in relation to the world. So she says, staying at house and home for the woman is so much defined in my country. Her entire life, her life in the world, is in the house. That's it. I'm a sister, mother, daughter, but when I walk, this is the way I can achieve myself. Subversive, infra-political, everyday, codified, or what we might view as micro modes of resistance, perhaps. Could we say that performance art is a way of expressing individuality and claiming one's own subjectivity? Absolutely. So in terms of utilizing or perhaps exploiting the everyday as a mode of resistance, we might see this as a small but powerful transaction within the hegemonic hierarchy. The hidden resistance, part of a concept termed infrapolitics by anthropologist James C. Scott, is summed up by anthropologist K. Sivaramakrishna in that the everyday form of resistance, quote, as opposed to spectacular outbreaks of revolutionary protest, relies upon the existence of subordinate groups and cooperation of class resistors. So my primary thesis research actually focuses on the phantasmagoria of the everyday as a mode of political upheaval. And beyond that, I'd like to ask that we observe additional modes of hidden revolutions or resistance within the everyday. So Peidon Sung, associate professor in the Department of History at Fudan University, highlights how clothing was a mode of hidden everyday resistance in China's Cultural Revolution. Sun asks, what was the impact of Maoism, or also known as the push for one dominant thought, if you will, on ordinary life in Guangdong province? In brief, residents in Guangdong did or did not engage in cultural practices of everyday resistance in clothing. Quote, personalized, gendered, and rationalized clothing practices, such as altering the sleeves, collars, waist, and trouser leg openings, can be seen as major expressions of people's resistance. Sun highlights a comparison of two parades, one in Harbin and one in Guangdong. A photograph taken in Harbin shows hundreds of thousands of people celebrating the anniversary together, conveying a strong political atmosphere. The first two rows of the podium are occupied by officials. Under the podium steps, six soldiers stand with their hands behind their backs, facing the podium with their backs to the masses. Several fully armed soldiers stand guard on the rally ground. Behind them is a sea of people, the revolutionary masses. In contrast, a picture taken on the same day at the Army and People's Commemoration Rally, jointly organized by Guangxu and Gaoshu, shows more than 20 female students walking past a podium wearing red scarves and holding flowers. Some of them are wearing frocks, others skirts, all in different colors and patterns. And I apologize, these are black and white photos, so we don't get to behold that. Wearing different colors and patterns with more than a dozen decorative designs. And many bystanders among the crowd, however, are barefoot, wearing straw hats or holding umbrellas. Even when taking in the contrast and local climates into account, the difference between Harbin and Guangzhou is profound. So last Friday, Dr. Robeson Tosh Frazier, Associate Professor of Communication at USC and Director of the Institute for Diversity and Empowerment at Annenberg, which is IDEA, discussed his journey to understanding forms of resistance within the African American diaspora, in particular relation to his understanding of the Black radical imagination in Cold War China. So what veiled or missed responses could we see concerning anti-hegemony? How do we rethink politics and cultural labor? So as Dr. Frazier proceeded to address these questions and his personal journey toward understanding himself within the overarching theories of African-American studies in relation to movements in China, there was one point of radical resistance that really stood out for me. During his youth, Frazier spent time in China and lived with a host family. And in one image he showed us, Frazier is welcomed by his hosts as they all dine together. And this was a point in Frazier's own words that might be considered a moment of veiled resistance. Yes, the everyday act of eating, which includes sharing knowledge with others, knowledge building and building relationships, is a radical act of resistance. As I mentioned earlier, this presentation is sort of serendipitous event for me, as I have a chance to reflect on earlier research that didn't make it into my thesis project as a whole, mostly explicitly. And so moving on here, we have filmmaker, journalist, Allison Clayman uncovers the world of the artist Ai Weiwei, one of China's most prolific modern day artists. In her film documentary, Ai Weiwei, Never Sorry, Clayman reveals the inner life of an artist who lives and breathes his dream to achieve a better life for the people living in China. When Ai Weiwei mentions at the beginning of Never Sorry, quote, "If I'd never met this cat that can open doors, I wouldn't know cats could open doors." He's really providing an allegory, one that provides us with a foundation for understanding his motivations with respect to the people of China. Part of what makes Ai Weiwei's influence so profound is in how he demonstrates that everyday activities can, in fact, hold meaning beyond their original intent. And it begins with a single earthquake event. So Allison Clayman's Ai Weiwei, Never Sorry highlights this aftermath of the 2008 Sichuan earthquake and its resulting controversy regarding or surrounding shoddy, quote, tofu construction in many of the affected regions. So more than 70,000 people were publicly reported dead. But where the controversy lies, which Ai Weiwei addresses in 2010, is in China's inaccurate death tolls, where Ai claims that the government underreported the deaths of many school-age children. He argues that the Chinese government concealed the actual number of school-age deaths. His response to this data omission launched one project, NEON, or known as Remembrance, a recording of more than 5,000 names of the unaccounted for children who perished during this earthquake. By recording the names of thousands of children and releasing it freely to the public, Never Sorry shows us how Ai Weiwei aims to critique the government's erasure of its own citizens and to bring to light those whom the government attempted to silence. Although the importance of finding these forgotten names of children in itself is significant, the journey to finding these names also demonstrates why NEON is such a special project. Never Sorry shows us how Ai Weiwei enlisted the help of everyday citizens to travel to regions that were affected by the earthquake to do the work the government should be doing. So when Ai and his team were collecting names in Chengdu, police assaulted Ai and he was severely injured. excuse me, during the filming of Ai Weiwei, Never Sorry, we follow Ai back to Chengdu, where he files official papers against the police regarding his assault. The very act of committing fully to this bureaucracy by way of filing police reports and creating paperwork, that in itself is an act of everyday resistance. So while waiting for the police department's response to his formal complaint, I and his team can be seen enjoying a meal outdoors, conversing and such. In a short amount of time, plainclothes and uniformed officers swiftly swarm the crew, videotaping I and his team while they eat in a public space in front of a restaurant. In a humorous twist, I's cameraman records the policeman who concurrently records the entire group of patrons, and the entire event is documented by Clayman. So collecting a set of names and dining in public may not seem like anything significant if viewed through a limited lens, but what Clayman shows us is the veiled activism in Ai Weiwei's practice. The veiled activism is contagious as it expands beyond Ai Weiwei himself. When people begin collecting a set of lost names and repeating it, or perhaps when Ai Weiwei teaches ordinary citizens to organize by helping them learn technologies that collect data and to communicate with others just more effectively. The importance of public dining emerges when we learn that citizens in affected areas by the from the earthquake were not allowed to organize in any way, which included mealtimes. This was a way to discover the government's intentional intentional misreported fatalities. It's possible. And to conclude, I would actually like to show you a short clip of Ai Weiwei's bureaucratic activism and a portion of the mealtime incident in Alison Clayman's Ai Weiwei, Never Sorry. So fingers crossed that this works. And following the clip, I will hand the torch over to Max from Quarantine Gallery. So let me get this clip going and see if it works here. Can you hear it? No sound. Some people say that if you have the headphones in, there's no sound. Let's see. Okay. It's very quiet. Let me see if I can just turn it up, maybe. Is that better?
The result had a little bit.
I asked him why he bothers to go through this process. He was wasting basically the whole afternoon on a process that he knew was ultimately doomed. And he said, well, you know, you can't just say that the system is flawed. You have to work through the system and show it in all of its detail.
Okay. And I actually need to get this. Whoops. Just a little, there we go. That's what I was looking for. Okay, let me just go back a little bit here. Okay,
good. Are
you expecting a successful result now?
The result had only simple.
I asked him why he bothers to go through this process. He was wasting basically the whole afternoon on a process that he knew was ultimately doomed. And he said, well, you know, you can't just say that the system is flawed. You have to work through the system and show it in all of its detail. And that's the only way that you can ultimately make a critique.
I just want to make sure, can you see the video? Okay, I was looking at your facial expressions and I was trying to gauge whether you could see it. So let me see if I can just take this out of full screen. I think that might be the issue. So if I put it in full screen, I think it takes it to a pause point in the share screen. So that's probably a copyright thing. So, okay, can you see my mouse arrowing over the play? Okay, we're gonna just play it from here. Okay, good? I'm getting no's. Oh, that's frustrating. I guess we could just, I'm not sure why it's not playing. Perhaps it's a copyright issue. I don't know why it would do that. Maybe I could, is there a chat window open here?
Jessica, if you click share screen on Zoom, and then you find the window.
Okay, so it's just sharing the wrong window. Yeah. Okay, bless you. Thank you. I'm gonna stop sharing for a second and reshare. Okay. Give this a go again. All right, that's not working. All right, something to do with the full. I don't know why it's not working. That's really strange. It has something to do with the when I put it in full screen. So I don't want to take up too much time here, but let me try this again. Can you see the video screen? Okay. I'm going to try playing it now, everyone, okay? Can you see that? Okay.
Allow them to take two person to write down this, so they really following the rules now.
Over the course of the afternoon, he'd been twittering about the fact that he was going to have dinner that night at a Laomati Hua restaurant, which is a place that specializes in a certain kind of pig's trotter. And as soon as we got to the restaurant, it was this weird sensation where all of a sudden these people who've been standing on the sidewalk, milling around, doing things, turned out to be people who had come to have dinner with him. Everybody there knew that by simply eating dinner there, it was an act of defiance.
二十是吧？对对对，都有。来，先坐，坐，看一下，你心满意足了，都有。大老远来，就觉得你们成都在外面吃很好吃，没听过呢。应该是的，应该是的。 The police doesn't know the power of the image, you know? They have their camera, we have our camera, but their camera is never going to be exposed to the public. We are going to expose it. So it's not fair game.
You have your
Tonight, the power of art and dissent in the digital age. We have a global exclusive. Which...
Okay, so I'm going to leave that there. Thank you very much for your time. And now I will, Stephen, are you all set to present? So I will pass the, actually, I'll pass it to Stephen and then we'll move on to Max after that. So thank you very much. And for anyone who's tuning in, please feel free to add your questions or comments in the chat window in the live stream YouTube. And this is Stephen Chen, guest speaker. Thank you.
Hi, thank you so much, Elizabeth and Jessica, for inviting me. It's a really great opportunity. I'll be doing a short reading of some writing I've been working on in sort of light of the sort of tentacular chaos that the coronavirus has sort of thrown us all into. And I just want to note before I present that the slides that I'll be showing along with my reading will consist of sort of quotes from relevant discourses or discourses that I'm writing through, and as well as some work, some of my own personal work interlaced between. So let's get started. Okay. Am I on? Okay. So the working title for the written piece is Love in the Time of Corona, or Holding Breath to Get Closer: A Politics of Virality in the Nascent Corona Scene, which is my sort of provisional term for not necessarily the sort of state of the sort of geological state or like epoch, but the sort of world that Corona has sort of worlded upon us. I also have talked frequently with my one of my best friends and collaborators, Charlotte Zhang, on this project. And with that, we'll begin. Part zero, entries. Currently, I am sitting on my porch. I watch the hill behind the fence. Sun's out, a few clouds open for a blue sky. How's the weather? Or more aptly, what's the weather? In Hyper Objects, Timothy Morton interrogates this quotidian platitude and its implications in worlding. Accordingly, it references or conjures a spatio-temporal, conceptual, structural, or material embodiment that obtains a nebulous specificity. A hyper-object, the weather as it flickers between the foregrounds and backgrounds that elude, encompass, or pass through our multitudinous amuls. Currently, Corona is the weather. Corona is worlding. It affects our sense of the world and is affecting in some hyperbolic ways. Corona was then, is now, is soon, and then later. Corona was here, Corona was there, is now here, and thus everywhere. Here, I want to consider a politics of virality. Contrary to virility, which asserts or bluffs an ontological condition corded with robust masculine hyperaggression, virality refers to a state of being viral, a sort of ontology that emerges through circulation, infection, contamination, deathly but not terminal, punctured and leaking fluid, and not still, not an absence of, weakened and weakening, intimate, aloof, invisible, but sensational, and not necessarily spectacular or sublime. While both terms, virility and virality, may qualify as bodily acts and as hyper-objects, or as simply hyper and express similar genomes, they do not share blood, yet spill it in negotiating viscous, vivacious post-colonial encounters. Indeed, the latter, virality, surrounds the former, virility, which itches, indicates, or threatens to push it out or clean away. The virus copies, duplicates, and lies dormant, even as it continually adjusts to, experiments with, and tests its circumstances. It confuses and levels the difference between life and non-life, while carefully taking advantage of the minutest aspects of their differentiation. Virality imagines vitality. It dreams of it, devours, then aspires towards it. It realizes and apprehends, emulates and reiterates it, hides from it, does it. Virality happens upon vitality. It invites itself in on a host. It is perhaps a vitality of its own right. And yet, Corona's capacity to perform vitality does not fully speak to its tentacular agency. One does not simply move on from the coronavirus as its critters errantly hop from one to the other, from others to the one, and right back to the other, and so on. Corona's agency is microscopic, yet massive, is all over world, is shady, yet persuasive to bronchial tissue, is statistically diffuse, yet compacts uniquely upon political and cultural differentiations. Corona distributes its own ecology onto other ecologies, inflicting itself on the worldly, yet personal, political, medical, physiological, biological, sexual, necrological, technological, economical. Corona's virality chooses vulnerable bodies and confuses, calibrates, or corrupts capable bodies. We do not currently have a solution, a vaccine, so fuck herd immunity. Corona has herded immunity, and so we exercise state-enforced herd prevention. Corona virality or vitality differs from Jane Bennett's distributive agency. It festers with an insidious disposition and urges to enact desperate yet fatal dispossession. Biologically, this constitutes as a dispossession of cells, the hollowance imminent and vital to human corporealities. Politically and similarly, the viral propensity to dispossess informs and incites a fear for the bodies into which the coronavirus looks for hosts to steal the houses of. A fear of being punctured, confused with, and then superseded by foreign agents. Of course, none of this is without the meddling of our current state of governance, which, since the 2016 elections, has committed itself to straining international relations, immigration bans, and contagious racist xenophobic rhetoric and literature. The vignettes of state language are bristled with these tragic splinters, which in hefty sweeps comb poor, homeless, black, racialized, queer, immigrated beings towards further fringe, enacting state-approved push out. And nevertheless, COVID-19 punctured the American livelihood, threatening to dissolve the fleshy cape of its cellular membrane, what had once promised to enforce a contained and controlled osmosis, now waits on the news instead. Corona is a terrorist turned US citizen, whether we like it or not. Now, we are being told to contain and control ourselves. The state implores us to practice social distancing, or more aptly, distanced socialization, to exercise self-quarantine, to auto-quarantine, which is now sim-quarantine. And given the recent surge of certain techno-fixes, such as Zoom, sim-quarantine, to be with virtually, to share vicarious space, to share through screens. So then what happens to making kin? An act once so embodied, so visceral, so material, albeit still possible through networks and networking, now caught in a knot that cradles few solutions, yet infinitely inconceivable possibilities. Yet I miss sharing air, bumping bodies and the feeling of flesh. I miss space-time in person, embodied proximity, vicinity, the palpable imminence of worlding with, but perhaps there is nothing to miss and only stuff to move on or without. How to make love in the time of Corona, how to get closer, how to go places, how to remember what once was not so. In what ways do we consist, resist, assist, and desist virality as it circulates through bodies, through weather and techno clouds? I got black, I got white. From one room through air vents to the next. From there, then on an airplane, a ship, a gust of wind, and now here and no longer once away. So while the reading doesn't necessarily mention China in terms of sort of in terms of Chinese thought, it definitely talks about sort of the strained international relations that the government has sort of been provoking and prodding at. But I'm also sort of concerned with not necessarily discourses that surround China, but definitely sort of the Asian American experience as sort of reconfigured, contested by, and destabilized in a way by the sort of advent of Corona, and also just by the sheer sort of language that Trump has used to sort of not only describe the virus but also disseminate its the language that surrounds it. So he called it Chinese virus, and then a day later he called it a Chinese virus, and then a few days later or a day later he apologized for Asian Americans getting attacked. So while I'm not necessarily bringing China as a nation into this discourse, I want to sort of talk about Asian Americanness, Asian American identity, as it relates to virality, as it relates to detection, invisibility, and legibility. So I really love, I haven't finished it, but I really, really love Ocean Vuong's new book, On Earth We're Briefly Gorgeous. And to sort of accompany the release of the book, he did a talk at APA, which I will currently share. The section that I'm mostly sort of that I'm sort of interested in, affected by, and concerned with. If I can just figure out how the fuck Zoom works. Okay. Where are we? We are here. Yes. Oops. There we go. Okay. Is it sharing the video? Good. Okay. So he's sort of giving his final comments after the talk, but I think these one of my professors, Pearl, actually showed me this, and I think it really sort of resonates with Asian American positionality. So here we go.
I'd like to make a final comment as an artist in residence in APA space. To me, it feels important to say a little bit about what it means to be an Asian American artist here, particularly widely an artist of color. And I see, you know, from glancing that there are many Asian American artists and many Asian Americans, period, here. And I just want to say that if you are going to be an Asian American artist, be prepared to be unfathomable to the rest of the world and the rest of the country. When it comes to Asian American innovation and agency, we are often legible when we are at service to larger structures in art, often Eurocentric ones. The great sociologist Summer Kim Lee calls this Asian American experience the after you embodiment, where Asian Americans are often asked to be the accommodators of larger forces in this country. We hold the doors, we nurse, we put our heads down, we wash the feet, we do the nails, we press the clothes, we iron it, we accommodate. And I think because of this, when it comes to Asian American talent, it is only legible when it is seen in service of Bach as prodigies or Beethoven. You can play the piano well as an instrument, a talented, finely tuned instrument of Western art. But when it comes to your own creation, you will not be legible. You'll be inconceivable. It is either innate, genetic, as it is when it comes to mathematics or science. It's in their genes. Or it comes through the inhumane disciplinarian parents, tiger moms and tiger dads, where the larger structure, the larger white parents can say, I would never put my son through that. So I will willingly forego talent and genius in order to preserve my humanity and compassion and ethical parents, thereby stripping the agency and the talent of the Asian American instrument. So when you dare to be a writer, a songwriter, a dramatist, an essayist, in other words, as an Asian American, when you dare to have your own agency, your own dream, when you no longer become the instrument, the empty vessel of larger pre-made art, you will be called pretentious. You will be called unrestrained. It will not be ready for your mind when it creates its own thing. That doesn't mean you shouldn't do it. You should do it, but be prepared, expect it. And even more so, why not? Why not be as ambitious as you want to be? Why not be pretentious? What is pretentious but to have the pretense to the assumption that you belong here? Be prepared to be inconceivable and then be prepared to innovate beyond that, because we need you and we are ready for it. Thank you.
Okay, so I just think the way he articulates this is just cosmic. But in terms of my own sort of notes on what Ocean is saying here in relation to, I'm sorry, Vyong. I just think of him such like a, as like kin, you know. But thinking about of Yang in sort of relation to virality, this is the sort of paraphrased version of the quote. And definitely in terms of sort of representation and Asian American is as a sort of as sort of resistant or repellent to sort of its own representation. And I also want to briefly touch on AIDS, just given the sort of, I don't know, the sort of parallels that are sort of being unearthed between these two forms of virality. I'm extracting these insights from Nathan Lee's essay on efflux becoming undetectable. Number one, he says that the AIDS crisis, as many have noted, is a crisis of representation. So is the Asian American identity, but I think it has gotten to a certain point where we can also, where representation isn't enough, and the crisis is not only designated within representation. Whatever the next step is, I don't know. Thinking about viruses, a production of the body as a desubjectivized multiplicity, and becoming imperceptible, which enables sort of an ontology to resist an immediate representation. So representation either becomes delayed or buried or invisibilized. And thinking about this in Corona, a lot of the sort of actual sort of graspable answers, solutions, whatnot that we've been stumbling across aren't sort of immediate in their appearance at all. There's a sort of delay, a temporal, I'm sorry, my internet, a sort of temporal inconsistency or disruption. The vibes of virality, these are some some more notes sort of cataloging the sort of relationships between the language that is being used not only around Asian American identity, but also the sort of discourse on virality that I'm trying to work within here at least. So we have illusion, which is an evasive sort of gesture. Illusion, which is representation, which is what we see or what we choose to see or what the other wants us to see. Invisibility as a strategy, invincibility. I think about invincibility in terms of sort of what my friend Charlotte has been working on. It's called Beefcake Theory. And it's a theory that is trying to reconfigure Asian American politics and shift it from this sort of gesture of dignity to something else. But you'll have to ask her about that. Illegibility, which I decided to insert another pun, illness, as a sort of inability to grasp or conceive or conceptualize an object or a being or a structure. Irresponsibility, which is borrowed from Donna Haraway's term responsibility. I really like this term because it not only sort of it highlights both sort of valences of the word, which is the sort of urge to act and also the ability to act. So you have a capacity to act, but you also have this sort of, you also have like an inclination to respond to something. And this is also figured as irresponsibility,
in terms of the government right now. The government is completely able, but it's, for some reason, we're not seeing anything. We're failing to see sort of palpable sort of solutions or even benefits to the state of governance. And some more puns, but that will conclude my talk for today. We're all in this together, by the way. That's that's the underlying message. Thank you for inviting me again, Elizabeth and Jessica. Thank you. How do I leave? Oh.
Hi, thanks so much, Stephen. That was wonderful. And thank you, Jessica and Elizabeth, for inviting me to take part in this as well. It's quite a strange time we're all living in, and I really appreciate having these conversations. My name is Max Rippon. I'm an artist in Los Angeles, and I'm also the co-founder of a project called Quarantine Gallery that's been really an initiative that started since the lockdown orders have begun here in the United States in general. And yeah, it came actually interesting, as you said, the responsibility, Stephen, you know, creating a response and taking responsibility for our own actions as artists and as a part of the art community. The initial goal with the project really is to support and to unite the creative community while everything that we're, you know, all of our venues and our outlets are being canceled or being closed. The immediate physical connections that we had were canceled, essentially. And immediately it was a sort of a knee-jerk reaction to say, you know, let's move, let's discover how we can adapt. I think adaptation is a key aspect of what we're living through. So I'll sort of cut the intro. And so basically what Quarantine Gallery is, we're an Instagram based for the moment. We are building a website, a platform for artwork and for artists from all over the world to reflect and to react in real time from their places of confinement. And it's very important for us that we are encouraging artists to work now. There's been a number of different initiatives that have shown works that were made before this happened, shows that were canceled. And while it is really important that, you know, all of these efforts and this work that artists put in is shown, we also wanted to really focus on building an archive, building a growing living archive of this moment, sort of like how you might keep a diary during this time. It's a way of not losing the details, of not forgetting the small emotions that we're living through in these moments. And the way that we're trying to do this actively in on the online project is we're every 72 hours, we're announcing a new, sorry, let me pull up my screen actually. I did have some things to do. Here we go. Sorry. Here we go. And here we go. So every 72 hours, we want to provide a prompt or an exhibition theme, if you will, that will inspire. A lot of people are feeling blocked right now. There's writer's block, there's creative block. People are not allowed into their studios or the studio's been closed. They have to work from new spaces. And this is something that we really want to explore and encourage. And the themes that we've been putting out during this project we want them to continue to change as the situation changes. Every day we have, whether we're having new lockdown measures or we're having, you know, now people are trying to lighten these measures. It's everything is happening so fast that real time is incredibly important to us. And by changing the exhibition themes every 72 hours, we want to give a sense of urgency to the artists. We also know that deadlines help us get things done. Sometimes it's very difficult for work to get done if it's sort of just seen as can go on forever. So real time is really what we want to encourage. So we immediately reached out to as many artists, curators, even some gallerists. We wanted to just build a community and a global community. We reached out with a wonderful quote in our artist call to action by Toni Morrison. It says, "This is precisely the time when artists go to work. There's no time for despair, no place for self-pity, no need for silence, and no room for fear." Unfortunately, we do have fear, and many of us maybe are feeling despair, desperation, disappointment, and depression. You know, it's a really difficult time, but through the creative act and feeling like we're part of a community, we're hoping that this will be just one of many initiatives that will help sort of motivate us during this time. And so I'll just go through a little bit of some of the submissions that we received. The first show, which actually caused us a few issues on Instagram, we had our account blocked when every show was under the theme of mass hysteria. That kind of that caused a few issues on Instagram. We got through it. So this is a submission of a work on paper from Cadi Paloma, who's an artist in Los Angeles. He's reacting to mass hysteria. The second theme was social distancing. This submission came from Dusseldorf in Germany, from the artist Dan Kunstler, as a performative act, as a documentative act. And we really wanted to encourage as many different kinds of works as possible to be submitted. New media, photography, documentation, drawing, painting, music, anything that really, however we're able to react and express ourselves during this time from wherever we find ourselves is really important. This was another work from an artist here in Los Angeles, Emmanuel Pickett, who went around when the lockdown orders started, and she's been continuing this project. She drove around to her friends and acquaintances' houses and shot them through the windows. It's a very poignant visual of how we're feeling and these moments that we're locked inside, we can't be with one another. This was also from the theme of social distancing. This was a submission that came from a show theme, Reset, which we felt that reset, the world is resetting itself in a lot of ways. We're seeing the climate clean itself up. We're seeing ourselves, we're getting an opportunity to be at home as well and to maybe think about what we really want to be doing. Do we want to be in this, grind constantly? Or do we want to maybe be making our artwork, reading, and communicating with our peers and with our family and friends? This was a very reflective piece from an artist in Mozambique who got in touch with us, Delilah Romeo David. And she photographed her own body and used filters and as a way of, relearning about her own body and resetting as well. This piece was from our next show called Cracks, which had to do with sort of looking at cracks as a way of allowing breaks in our foundation and our ways of working. And we also used a quote from Leonard Cohen, what said, there's a crack in everything. This is how the light gets in. So cracks are our destructive force in our foundations, but can also allow for new opportunities and new possibilities. So this is an artist, Ariana Minai, who's an Iranian artist who's studying at Yale at the moment, finishing up her MFA in painting. And she's worked on these small handmade paper pieces with using pressed bricks into these surfaces. And it's a wonderful piece. Next, we went on to the theme of time. I think we're all sort of experiencing a very warped period of sense of time right now. Time goes incredibly quickly during the days, but we're also in this cyclical time where every day is like the last, a bit like a Groundhog Day situation. Let me see. I don't know, are you guys seeing this video? Okay, I got the video to work. So this is a generative sketch that was turned into a video from an artist in Edinburgh, Scotland, and with writings and drawings and doodles sort of considering around what's going on and placed into a time-based medium. So we can just watch through this. One of the key goals is really to create a global community and a global platform for artists to connect during all of this. We're all, Stephen, you said we're all in this together, but also one of the things is that we're all alone in this together. We're alone together. So we're here sitting on our own in our rooms, but we're communicating with one another, and we're actually reaching out to one another in ways that I don't think many of us would have normally if we had our daily lives. I've spoken to people I haven't spoken to in years, and we just know where we're going to find each other. We're not going to be busy. We're not going to be running around. One of the most recent themes is on another shared experience that we have of insomnia, which is, a state of anxiety, but it's also a period where sometimes our most creative ideas come out. So this is a piece that was an audio visual piece created by the artist Iman, who is from the earth. And it was a montage of Hyatt video laid over with drum and bass music slowed down and laid over to us. We'll watch this for a minute. Oh, there we go. Can you guys hear this as well? Oh, sorry, there's music involved with it, but maybe. Let's see if I can put it, maybe take it off. To show is some of the themes that we're working with and where the artists are coming from and the different types of works that we're exhibiting. It's really important that we have as many different perspectives as possible. One of the other key prompts that we give to artists that we want them to share a story, they share the working process, share a caption about what they're living with in this moment. Seeing a work in isolation without the context of where people are from, especially in this moment, just doesn't give the whole story. And we want to give a voice to the works, but we also want to amplify people's personal experiences. This is actually something we want to continue to develop with the platform. We want to start every Sunday doing a Sunday Salon reading series, which we really encourage anybody who's listening to us to reach out to us if you want to do a reading. We're speaking with our artists who've already submitted. And we really want to bring, just amplify the ways in which we can discuss what's going on and share our experiences and our ideas. On a side note as well, this project is actually being presented as part of a curatorial class that I'm taking part in that I began at the beginning of the year before all of this, which is commissioning and curating contemporary public art, which is with a course with the University of Gothenburg in Sweden, which has already been an online course since the beginning. But we've been examining different ideas of publicness and how our public spaces function, the hierarchies that are involved in it, the systems, the societal systems that are involved in it. And this is really giving quite an interesting framework with which to examine the current situation that we're in. It's just opening up these different perspectives and different questions that can really be beneficial to seeing what the repercussions of all of this are. And really one of our ultimate goals is that while we want to motivate people and create a platform, we want to stand as a curated archive of work that's made during this time from all over the world, made from a place of confinement. And we want it to be in real time. So we want to see the themes develop. We want to see how people's emotions develop, how they shift during this time. And we want it to be, it's too early to really offer any answers to what's happening or what is going to happen. But I think that really now the questions that we start to ask will have repercussions for many years. This is an incredibly historical time. And it's important that we start to ask these in the context of how we're feeling in the moment. It's very easy to sort of forget these. And some of the questions that we really want to ask, you know, are we going to look at how online media and social media have shifted incredibly since over this time? You know, I think that the human investment that we're placing in platforms such as Zoom or Instagram Live, they've shifted incredibly fast. Whereas before, maybe we had classes or a few business meetings on Zoom, anything beyond that might have seemed a little bit crass. Now I've heard of friends who've had to attend funerals on Zoom because they're not allowed to see their family members who've passed because of COVID or other reasons. I've also heard of weddings, and I've heard of concerts being celebrated all across, you know, 3, 4, 5 continents. And it's so the human investment we're placing to these media is really interesting. And I think that it's worth exploring at this moment. And, you know, also the idea of the art world as being something that if, you know, someone suggesting go see a virtual exhibition before just might have seemed a little bit bland. And maybe it does to some people still. I know that we are all kind of, we're eager to get back to our physical touch and to our physical communities. But, you know, the reality of the situation is that we can't right now. But, you know, are the way that we're working now, are these situational trends, or are these going to be lasting change in all of these platforms? You know, are we seeing maybe some of the cracks in the facade of the art world? We've certainly seen how the political system is failing quite drastically. And, you know, certain governments are doing better than others. And examining how different global systems are doing better or worse with this situation. And then again, this is why we want to hear from artists from everywhere possible. And also another thing is, you know, the solidarity that we're feeling now. We're reaching out to one another more than ever, but is this a passing moment? Are we going to become very selfish in our needs and our, you know, when things really start getting bad and when things go back again? I mean, these are just some of the questions that we want to present and you know, discuss on this project. So, and I'll wrap that up there. And thank you so much again for having me in to speak today. And please do get in touch, any artists, curators, anybody who wants to speak to us or share their thoughts, you know, feel free to get in touch. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Max, Stephen, and Jessica, for all giving great and wonderful talks. So we're going to begin our Q&A session, and because we are a little over time, we're going to spend just about 10-15 minutes. So first I would like to open up if anyone has a question to go ahead and answer. Or not answer, ask.
Hello, can you hear me? So I'm noticing that there aren't any questions on the YouTube stream right now, but I'd like to ask you, Liz, we were talking a little last night about your triangle and how it could in fact be a shape with many more sides. I was wondering maybe if you could go into that discussion just for a brief little time, because the triangle you shared was, what was it, Japan, China, and the US, correct? And so you were mentioning it could have gone beyond that because of different intersections or interjections, perhaps. So I'd appreciate hearing from you on that.
For sure. And I've only been recently reading about this triad of interconnectedness of economies and just cultural exchange in general. So I too am still learning about it and been thinking through it, especially with just how globalized we have become in this moment and how that has truly shaped our identities based on local regions and then just the world at large. And it's definitely come up with this whole coronavirus incident when one market decides to close, what happens to every single market that is involved with that person's or that country's decision to close. So the triangle, from what I was reading and I understood, was for the original one that has been mostly discussed is France, Japan, and the US, where France and the US were colonizers to Japan. And over time, there had just become this continuous cycle of interconnected economies and the sharing of cultural exports. So in kind of maybe overthinking some things, but also taking note of what I currently see in the financial landscape and just markets in general, the triangle really could be in like a hexagonal, just a crazy, like, different point kind of thing where it's like Ireland, US, Japan, France, because of transnational corporations like Amazon that are going to like through all of these countries. And therefore the exchange flow is just this constant bouncing everywhere at any moment. So that's kind of how I was thinking through the problems of this triangle and just rationalizing what's going on now.
Thank you.
I have, because I don't see too much in the comment section for questions, but definitely lots of love for Stephen and Max as well. And we know that we definitely appreciate your talks. And I do want to ask you, Stephen, really quick, because I kind of like this chain that you had brought up of the coronavirus turned terrorist turned U.S. citizen, and how this new U.S. citizen is in a way evoking this violent language, especially within the Asian American community. And so I was wondering if maybe we can talk a little bit about maybe possible outcomes of the, like, the terms that you were bringing up before of like invisibility of artists through this virus that has been dropped on us, you know?
Well, I would say that the sort of violence that Asian Americans have been facing is certainly dialed down, given that the sort of framework that Corona has been sort of that at least the government has been using to present news about Corona has sort of shifted from, again, from a sort of foreign Chinese virus, Chinese virus, into everybody in the every American's problem right now. Even those who are in power, as we have seen with sort of nascent infections of, of certain people who hold power, certain elderly ontologies, as I would like to, as I like to call them sometimes. But given the sort of, given my sort of personal experience with the way that Corona has worlded the US, at least, I remember myself and a lot of my roommates and my friends being sort of challenged by not only the sort of affective climate that Corona has sort of induced in social spaces, especially in grocery stores, for instance, and any sort of public space. And just for, you've heard all, you've seen the memes about Karen's, Karen-splaining, as I like to call it, Karen-splaining to racialized people in public spaces, how to act or carry their own bodies in those spaces. I personally have been yelled at in a parking lot for no apparent reason. Yes, I live in Santa Clarita, so it's a bit, we're still a sort of considerably a red area in California. But now that sort of the sort of terrorist aspect of Corona has sort of dialed down. I mean, it's still really prevalent, and it still sort of undergirds a lot of discourses that are surrounding the virality of the coronavirus. I think it's definitely, at least in my personal experience, I can't speak for every Asian American or person who's affected by this, but in my personal experience, it's definitely dialed down. In Santa Clarita, everybody's wearing masks, and therefore visibility and invisibility the lines are sort of blurred between those as well. They're sort of challenged and destabilized and collapsed onto each other now that you can't really tell if a person is sick, has corona, or they're just doing their, you know, civic duty in protecting other citizens. In terms of invisibility as well, I just have to reference Vuong again. This invisibility sort of figures in Asian American representation, especially Asian American representation in forms of dominant personhood. The stuff we see in movies, the stuff we see in Hollywood, Crazy Rich Asians, blah, 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 blah. All of these sort of carry inherent problematics in how they are representing Asian Americans. No, we are not all filthy rich. I cannot speak for myself, but I'm happily in the middle class, but we're not all crazy, ultra rich, filthy rich people. And we don't necessarily materially occupy or politically occupy dominant spheres in sort of systematic structures. We don't necessarily have that in yet. But these sort of movies that sort of profess and sort of evoke this sort of empowerment, the sort of dignity that surrounds Asian American representation are actually falsifying that representation, which is why I don't think representation is enough anymore. I don't have the answer. But given the sort of recent politics that have emerged around Asian Americanness, I'm extremely disappointed and ready for new discourse to sort of emerge, which has been emerging around my peers. Charlotte is really just brilliant and has brilliant writing around sort of destabilizing our conceptions of what it means to be an Asian American identity, what it means to be an advocate for Asian American identity, and what it means to be racialized in the US. And these are the sort of, and a lot of the language that I'm working with is also definitely, it is funneled through her during our conversations, just about being, you know, yellow bodied or brown bodied. And I hope that answered your question. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Stephen. And before I guess I end our session with one last question. Does anyone have any other questions they wish to ask at this time? All right. So then I will go ahead, and this question is for Max. And in thinking about also Jessica's talk about the resistance through the everyday, would you see this quarantine gallery as a form of everyday resistance, in a sense that artists are refusing to stay put, but rather continue to showcase their emotions, feelings, and surroundings around them in this time of lockdown?
Yeah, I think that, thank you for the question. I think that I wouldn't necessarily call it everyday resistance, as I wouldn't say that we're in an everyday situation. It's quite an extraordinary situation at the moment. And I think that artists are in the position where we've been, especially in your classes, we're looking at critical frameworks and societal frameworks that we've been living within and underneath for time. So when we see those frameworks shatter around us in a matter of weeks, whether we're simply drawing or writing or speaking to friends, we're in a position where we can start to enact the resistance that we've already been feeling. And I don't like giving sort of universal truths, but I think that this is kind of a time that it's one of the only times that I can think where real change might actually occur. And so absolutely there's, the politics of the everyday and the resistance in our everyday actions are incredibly important. And now I think they're almost more important. It's difficult to be doing it because, it's difficult for it to be visible in that everything's online and there's a lot of noise and there's a lot of great initiatives. There's some that aren't so great, but there's a lot of really important things being talked about right now. And I think our sharing and our communal activities can really help bring us forward after this. And I think that that's sort of some of our primary concerns in the gallery, but also within, a lot of other conversations. There's, and everybody I speak to is, what's going to happen after this? These are, temporary, it's a temporary situation, but with very long lasting effects. It's also, as you guys were speaking about just now, that the cultural divides that have been exacerbated by this, the racism that's come out of it, across many different countries against various different people, has been, it's really shocking. And I think that we've also been seeing for the past few years, a strong shift in, very nationalistic isolationist policies from various different governments around the world. And that provides one way that this world could go after this. And then is there, but we as artists and as people wanting to build community, I think we're trying to look at a different way out of this and trying to build our own resistance of, if it's not done, if we don't do something about it, it's going to be done for us. And I think now is the time to be doing that. But it's hard. Any artist I speak to who says, oh, you know what, I'm really not feeling it right now, I just really can't do it, I said, absolutely, that's totally understandable. Like, we want to be motivating with our project, but we don't want to be, didactic and telling people this is what you have to do either. You can sit at home, cry in your pillow for 2 days. That's okay. It's understandable right now. But at some point, we want to help people get up and discuss and resist in some way.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you.
And it's a little bit over, about 15 minutes over of what our scheduled time was. So I want to just close it out really quick and say thank you to all those who stuck around and have viewed us. And thank you, Stephen and Max, again for joining us. We very much appreciate it and hope you stay well, healthy, and sane.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Thank you so much. It was so great to have this conversation.
Thank you very much.
And to hear you guys speak. Thank you.
Yeah, you guys too.
Thank you, everyone.
Stay healthy. Stay positive.
You too.
You all too.
Stay at home.
Thank you.
All right. Thank
you. Take care. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.